Hey folks, welcome back to the Spectrum Synth tutorial series. This is part two of my two-part series on the interactor modules. In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how to affect different parts of the instrument with the interactors. The interactors can be patched to targets in the standard way, from the wavetable router and from the patchers in Grand Central Station. Here I've got interactor 1 set up to control the wave shape choice. I've simplified this patch so that you can clearly hear that the wave shape choice is controlled by the interactor step sequence. Of course, if I play two notes, then the transposition of the interactor messages will be bouncing back and forth, transposed by the two notes that I'm playing. This button here will count the number of notes that you're playing before advancing to the next step. So if I were to play three notes, then it would play out three eighth note events before advancing to the next step. In this example, I'm changing the number of notes that are playing, and you'll be able to hear the interactor not advancing until the number of notes has been accumulated. There are two more buttons to discuss, but I'm going to hold off describing them for the minute. In this example, as well as having the interactors controlling wave shape choice, this choice here allows messages from the wavetable router to appear at Grand Central Station as a modulation source. I've assigned that modulation source to control the X parameter of the animator pad. It's difficult to see X activity unless we have a Y movement as well, similar to the way oscilloscopes work. So I'm using a low-frequency oscillator to move the y-axis just so that we can see traces on the animator pad. I'm using the animator pad to control the delay amount, and I'm also having it modulate the wave shape choice and the intensity of the wavetable distortion. I could have simplified that patch by choosing the interactor from the Grand Central Station menu, but I wanted to show you the opportunity to transmit messages from the wavetable router to the Grand Central Station. Now let's look at some more ways of patching the interactors to targets. I'm going to choose the FM initialization patch. And let's assign interactor 1 to the FM oscillator. Since I want to write some new values in the transposition sequence, I'm going to change the pattern selection up to a higher number to avoid inadvertently changing the values of an existing pattern. I rolled up the pattern 45, which is blank. Now I'm clearing the transpose, and I'm going to set some interesting values in here to transpose the FM oscillator. I'm going to set this to 8 steps and have a traditional incremental position set up here. And now you're going to hear something that doesn't sound at all right. I'm going to play a few notes. That doesn't sound right. Ah, that last one did. So now we're heading into the gnarly world of voice allocation in Spectrum Synth. The interactors are monophonic objects, and what we're hearing here is that my instrument being set to 4 voice is showing that some of the note articulations are not getting the interactor messages. The quick fix for that is to set the FM oscillator into unison mode, and that way each interactor message will actually trigger all 4 voices of the FM department. Double-clicking on this control sets the unison mode to 4. And there, our problem solved. This FM initialization patch is using an envelope generator to control the FM audio amount. If you're familiar with FM synthesis, you'll know that the amplitude of the modulating oscillator is usually controlled by an envelope generator, and that's exactly what we have here. Envelope generator 2 is controlling the FM oscillator volume, and here we see envelope generator 2 from the envelope generator stacked macro, and it's showing that there's a decay with 0 sustain value. I'm just going to move up the sustain to full. So you can hear the interactor actually switching the pitch of the FM modulating oscillator. The FM initialization patch that we started with is using the FM oscillator and solo oscillator 1. Let's use a second interactor and assign it to solo oscillator 1. This interactor will now replace the sustained gate that was playing oscillator 1 with a re-triggered gate triggered from the rate of the interactor. So now we're creating chopped up events with our oscillator number 1's envelope. We can adjust the gate time here to add a sustain element to the events from the interactor. Let's switch the rate of the second interactor to 16th notes. We can add another interactor to control the wavetable section independently. Let's use number 3. So we'll hear the interactor just doing normal arpeggiation and transposition here on the wavetable sound. Setting that independent component was easy because the wavetable section has its own envelope generators. When it comes to using the pool of envelopes that are available from Grand Central Station, things get a little more complicated. All of those envelopes are already being fired by the second interactor that we used to set up the control over solo oscillator 1. As an example of dealing with that, let's bring in solo oscillator number 2, and instead of assigning it an envelope from the envelope generator pool, we'll set it up to work with the auxiliary envelope. The auxiliary envelope is found on the B panel, and we have to assign the usage of the auxiliary envelope by making that choice right here. Now we can turn on interactor 4 and assign it control over the solo oscillator number 2. So with this setup, interactor 4 will fire the auxiliary envelope, and the auxiliary envelope will control the volume of solo oscillator 2. I'm just going to turn off the other sounds so that we can hear solo oscillator number 2. Let's set it to a slower rate so that we can distinctly hear it with the other sounds playing. This patch had the FM amount affecting solo oscillator 2, so I'm just going to switch that off. In another tutorial, I'll talk about how to set up a split keyboard so that the interactor can work on a certain range of the keyboard. The last point I want to make is that this button enables the arpeggiation order to be following the lowest note to the highest note when you play a chord. When this button is off, then the order is controlled by the way it is assigned to voices in Reactor, and that's not always the same order as the order in which you play your notes. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. Thanks for watching.